I did a PhD at the Women's and Children's Hospital working on lysosomal storage disorders. And I wanted to put this in context because it was a translational research group. So they weren't just concerned with understanding the fundamental causes of the disease, but really wanted to try and tackle, can we make a treatment for this disorder? So you can see the electron micrograph on the left. There is a lysosomal storage disorder cell, whereas you can see the characteristic vacuoles in the panel on the right. So they actually took a multidisciplinary team and took a number of different approaches. So they looked at So they looked at enzyme replacement therapy, gene therapy, stem cells, and I could see that you could get a patient come in and then have a treatment for this disorder in the laboratories in which I was working. So you could see this translational research. They successfully developed screening and a treatment, which was really inspirational. So then I went on to do my postdoc at a biotechnology company called Bionomics. And what I really learned here was the most rapid way to develop a drug is to use platforms and pipelines. So the idea that you'll have experts with specialist skills in different areas of biology, such as bioinformatics, using computers to look at the gene regulation and looking at targets they can identify. And then high throughput screening in cell biology to try and identify drugs which then affect those cells. The next thing is to use chemists in a discovery program, so you're using medicinal chemistry to try and make a series of different compounds that can then target your cells. And then the next thing is to then do preclinical animal testing, so finding a model system where you can test. So I was working on cancer research, so we looked at the inhibition of cell growth, we then looked at a series of different compounds, and then used animal models. And again, in my time there, I saw the transition of a chemical from a series of compounds to an actual clinical candidate that was going into people in my time at that company. So now I'm at UniSA in the Centre for Drug Discovery, and I highlighted those points to say that we also have our own platforms and pipelines. We have computer-aided drug design where we can discover candidates. We can look at the interaction of a chemical with a target within the computer. Then we have a series of chemists, so we can flow down to the next stage where they use medicinal chemistry, and we can guide that using biochemical assays, cell biology assays, and also animal studies. So that what we can do is get a series of compounds and modify them to try and increase our activity. And this is all target driven. So the idea is that we really want to target cancer. So as it was alluded to, I'm looking at kinase inhibitors. So what is a kinase? So it's a protein which can regulate another protein by adding a phosphate. So you can see in the diagram on the top, you get a substrate, the kinase catalyzes the addition of the phosphate. So what do the kinases do? They regulate processes by altering the function of the protein. So what we're looking at now is cell cycle. So cell cycle is the replication of the cells. So you can see in the bottom panel, a cell with its condensed chromosomes, which is then segregating and forming two sister cells. So what we want to try and do is inhibit this process. So can we stop cell division? And we want to do this in a specific case of cancer. So cancer are abnormal cells dividing without the normal controls. They're able to invade other tissues. So can we find a kinase inhibitor that can stop the cell cycle, which is specific to cancer? So we're using what's called an analog drug approach, which is where we take a known compound. So we have a compound which is known as a mitotic kinase inhibitor. So it's stopping the cell division of cancer cells. It's effective in the clinic, but has poor metabolic stability and bad bioavailability, meaning it can't be given as an oral drug. It has to be given as an injectable. So using this structure of this compound, the medicinal chemist can create new intellectual property, which is crucial for actually getting a drug developed. If it's not new intellectual property, no one will invest the money. So what we want to do is identify a new compound. So we did that and identified MK18 as a compound as our lead. So what we're trying to do is retain activity and improve activity and also improve the metabolic stability and bioavailability. I won't talk about that today, but I'll just show the kind of results we got in terms of activity. So the first thing we do, as I said, we have platforms and pipelines. The first kind of platform assay we have is an MTT assay. So basically it's a yellow dye added to make a purple dye. And if you do that, when the purple dye forms, it means the cells are still alive. So you can see on the panel on the left, the red line is our compound. With increasing concentration, we see that we get cell death in at a lower concentration than that parent compound 0019910. So you can see that what we've done is actually not only retained activity, but also increased potency. If you look on the right panel, there's some normal cells. So that's what's happening in skin cancer cells. If you look at normal cells, those same drugs aren't having an effect on the cell viability. So what we're actually achieving is a selectivity. So we're specifically targeting the cancer cells while leaving the normal cells so that they can continue to divide. So how is this occurring? So I'll bring up the picture of cell cycle again. So you see in the top left panel, we have the cell cycle. There's the division of the cells where they have a cell starts off with its single complement of DNA, then there's a synthesis stage where it doubles, and then there's mitosis where those chromosomes segregate to make the two separate cells. So on the bottom panel you can see there's a peak on the left which represents cells that only have one set of DNA, whereas the peak on the right would indicate they have two sets of their DNA but haven't divided yet. When we treat with our compound, you can see what we get is a shift from the peak on the left on the top panel to the right. And that's occurring in our compound at a much lower concentration than the parent, the original compound that we based our drug upon. And it's also not occurring in the normal cells, indicating again that we're getting a mitotic kinase, we're getting an inhibition of cell cycle. So what's happening is we're getting the cells pause at a stage of having two sets of their DNA. So now we've got an idea of the mechanism of action that's occurring in here, and it's still the same as the parent drug we started with. The next thing we did was take this into animal models. So we've shown in cell biology that it's actually working. Can we make it work in an animal model? So the animal model we have is the xenograft model. So we took those same cancer cells and injected them into the side of the mouse. And what happens is a cancer forms a ball and starts growing. And then we can measure the growth of that tumour and treat the mouse with a drug. So you can see the far left panel, we have the vehicle control, which is no drug, compared at day 7 to the treatment with our compound. And you can see there's a marked decrease in the size of the tumour, indicating that what we're getting is an inhibition of the growth of the tumour. And we're getting up to a 52% delay in the growth of that tumour. We've also treated with cisplatin, which is a classical chemotherapeutic, but the difference is our drug is given orally, whereas this drug has to be injected and also has a lot of toxic side effects. So what we've done is made an orally bioavailable drug, which can decrease the size and delay the growth of the tumour. Then when we also look at the survival, you can see in the dotted line on the right panel is where you don't treat with a compound, whereas when you give our compound or the cisplatin as a control, you can see that we get an increase in the survival. So it looks like our compound is showing at least comparable activity to a classical chemotherapeutic, yet we've made it orally bioavailable. So I think that really gives you a quick overview of what we're doing at the Center for Drug Discovery. So what we have is a series of different compounds. We can then sort them using that MTT assay to find out which ones have not only activity, but improved selectivity so that we can hit cancer cells specifically. The next thing is chemists always like to make more compounds, so they use medicinal chemistries to make variations upon the compound, then also understand the mechanism of action. So there's always trying to figure out exactly how the molecular mechanism works. There's also replication of that xenograft and also testing other cell lines. So will this work on different cancers or is it going to be specific to a few? And then also you saw there was a decrease in the growth of the tumour with our compound and the cisplatin. But what happens when we combine them together? Can we get an increase in the effectiveness of these drugs? So there are the groups of people that have worked in the Centre for Drug Discovery and Development, and I'd like you to come talk to us at some stage about our research.
Thanks, Julie.
Thank you. Right, I'd like to welcome our next early career researcher speaker this evening, and that's Dr. Margarita Tsiros. Margarita's in the School of Health Sciences. She's a lecturer. She teaches, but she does research, which for me is like, that's the ultimate job. I love that. And she's going to tell us about obesity, the new childhood disability. So, Margarita, please.
Excellent. Thank you very much for that introduction.
Before I talk too much about my research, I thought I'd just give you a bit of background about myself. So I am a physiotherapist by training, and I always aspired to be one. So from about the age of 3 or 4, in fact. And it all started with my pet duck, so not terribly unlike this one here. And it got a sore leg. And I decided that I was going to rehabilitate this duck. So every day I'd get it into a tub of water and do water exercises with it, and I'd, you know, do other exercises with it, and eventually this poor duck did actually get better. And it was from that point that I decided I want to be a physiotherapist. So you can imagine by the time I actually walked across that stage holding my Bachelor of Physiotherapy parchment that it really was a dream come true for me. So I went on to practice exclusively as a clinician for 8 years, and I specialised very early on in the field of paediatrics, so working with children and families. And essentially I worked with children with disabilities and special needs, doing a range of different things with children and their families. And it was really through this work that I started to notice the impact that overweight and obesity actually seemed to be having on children's movement and everyday functioning. But when I actually started to have a look through the literature, I couldn't really find a lot about it, and there were not many physios actually working in this area. So I thought to myself, well, I actually want to go and do this research, but I didn't have the research skills to do it. So I got in touch with UniSA and decided to stick my toe in the water and undertake a graduate certificate in research methods. So I did that online and continued to work full time. And then I actually decided to do an honours degree. So I did that full time but continued to work 3 days a week. And then I thought, okay, I'm going to resign from my job and do a PhD full time. And I finished that in mid 2012, and then went off on maternity leave for a while after that. Now, my honours and PhD research I did with a fantastic group of supervisors who gave me fantastic support, and they were through the Nutritional Physiology Research Centre here at UniSA. And I was also lucky to be able to work with a whole team of other collaborators as well. So what did I look at in my PhD research? So it was really around asking this question: is obesity the new childhood disability? So does obesity actually impact the way children move and function in their everyday lives? So we know in Australia that around 1 in 4 children are either overweight or obese, so it does impact quite a large number of children. We know that children with obesity have poorer well-being and quality of life. And we know that obesity is very difficult to treat. So particularly when we look at adult populations, even if they are successful in losing weight, the bad news is that when you look at the literature, about 4 to 5 years later, they tend to gain all that weight back, plus more. Now, we think we have the capacity to make more effective changes in children because their behaviours are not so ingrained, but it's still a very challenging condition to treat. So we know that physical activity is key, not only for weight maintenance, but also for maintaining good health. But I really had to ask the question of whether we're actually going about this in the right way when it comes to children with obesity. So they're rapidly growing and they're carrying around all this extra weight. So I undertook a multi-centre study recruiting across about 240 children from around Australia, and I answered my research question. And in short, I think that yes, obesity is the new childhood disability. So let me tell you why I think this. So with my research, I was able to show that children with obesity actually have limitations in everyday simple tasks. Okay, so I'm talking about things like walking, climbing stairs and getting up from a chair. And that was compared with healthy weight peers. We also found that they have reductions in their knee strength and fitness, and this was particularly when we actually corrected for the amount of body mass that they were carrying around, okay? So what they actually need to do in everyday life. But of most concern to me as a physio was this, and that is that they actually had more intense pain in more locations throughout their bodies, and particularly in their lower limbs. So that's actually very concerning. because we're actually talking about 10 to 13-year-olds here. Okay, so it's quite a young age group. And perhaps most importantly, I've found that when we actually put these factors together, so being obese, having low fitness and strength, and having pain, that this actually translates into poorer physical well-being. So those factors actually matter, and if we want to improve children's physical well-being, we need to really try and do something about this. So that was my next question. Well, what can I actually do about this? So my research suggests that we actually need to be screening children for pain, and if they do have that, then we need to manage and treat that. So by referring on to appropriately trained health practitioners, so people like paediatric physios, for example, is one example. But we also need to make sure that we're actually prescribing the right sort of exercise. So making sure that what we do recommend isn't going to aggravate existing pain or actually cause pain. So for some children who are very obese, for example, is running around the oval doing, you know, vigorous activity actually going to be the best thing for their growing bodies? My research suggests that we actually need to take a three-pronged approach to children's activity. So it's important to increase overall activity, so doing things like walking to school or getting off the bus, you know, a couple of stops early and walking. But we also need to be incorporating strengthening programs and also activities that make them huff and puff a bit to actually improve their fitness. But at the same time, we need to be targeting their pain as well and making sure the activity overall isn't aggravating their pain. Now, my research suggests that if we actually take this combined approach to children's activity, that we may actually be able to get them moving better. And if we can get them moving better, then we may be able to change this to this, so actually getting them more active. And you'd think that this would actually assist obesity management in the long term. So that's enough about my research. What I want to talk to you now is just a little bit about where research has led me. So what might this path hold for you if you decide to come down this pathway? Well, towards the end of my PhD, I was successful in securing an academic position here at UniSA, so as a lecturer in physiotherapy and paediatrics. And I have to say that I really love my job. It's challenging, it's inspiring, and it really combines my clinical expertise but also my research passion as well. And I'm really able to actually continue my current research in my role. So some of the things I'm interested in at the moment is looking at, well, what factors are actually linked with quality of life and particularly physical functioning in children with obesity, and also how different types of inactivity or sedentary activity actually predict how much body fat children are carrying as well. Doing a PhD has actually broadened my skills beyond what I would have ever have been able to do had I continued just in clinical practice. And in my current role, I have the opportunity to actually have a direct impact on the practice of future health professionals. So that's something that I see as being very powerful, but also really important. And I just really want to highlight that doing a PhD is so much more than just a project. When I came in to do a PhD, I was just, you know, very focused, it's a project. But there's so much more, and there were so many other opportunities that I would have never have imagined. Things like publishing papers, going to conferences, networking, so many opportunities. I can't even begin to describe all of them. But I have to say, in terms of meaningful life moments, getting married, you know, having my two children, they're certainly way up there. But I have to say that graduating from my PhD was also right up there. And I've often referred to my thesis as my third baby. So it's quite, you know, a very meaningful life event. But also I've had the opportunity to contribute world-first knowledge. So to do something new and innovative and something that actually matters to the broader world. I've also been able to receive recognition for my research. So different awards, publishing in journals, and also to build many new networks. And this is really important in terms of getting your research message out there. But also my research has been able to have an impact. And this is another area which I didn't foresee coming in to do a research. So at a local level, I've been able to engage with people in the community. So this is an example of a research stand that we had out at Westfield Marion, but also through presenting research findings to health professionals and researchers through various invited talks. at a national level, I've actually been able to have some input and to have a bit of say around parliamentary policy regarding childhood obesity. Again, something I would have never foreseen. And also being able to get that research method out to the broader community, so through different media releases and newspaper and television and those sorts of media. It's really important. And also to general health professionals and researchers through conferences. But also internationally, and this is mainly towards the scientific community in terms of publishing research and also doing some book publications as well. But I think ultimately what research has enabled me to do is to do something I'm very passionate about, and that is actually work towards improving the health and well-being of children with obesity. So I've been able to have a much farther reach doing that by having a research capacity than if I had, say, just continued on in clinical practice. And I've done this through a multifaceted approach. So not only getting the research findings out to researchers, but also to those who are actually at the coalface, so parents and children and those important people around them. And finally, I just want to highlight that any research is always done in a team. It's never done in isolation, and I've been very lucky to actually have a really strong team of people behind me and supporting me through this as well. So thanks.
Still going to work with pets because I've got a 15-year-old cat with a bad hip.
I decided not to go into animal physiotherapy. So you know what they say, you know, either choose animals or children. So I chose children.
Okay, yep. Fair call. Thanks, Margarita. Thank you.